Okay, so we talked a lot yesterday about calculation and simulation. This is actually a nice combination. And also we've got Teresa coming on later on talking about reconciling the two. This is actually very, very mathematically heavy. So we're not going to go into equations. What I felt is it'll be nice to pick out one or two simple points out of the equations and just really look at them in a simplified way. And if you take that away, then you actually, that gives you a feel for what's there. But otherwise, obviously, you can't spend all the time looking at the equations. You will see there, it's round trip time under incoming traffic conditions. And this paper, which was presented to the symposium, looked at four special conditions. In fact, it's been overtaken by events. And we've got another paper published, which actually is much better written in a way and looks and tries to encompass all the conditions. So I'll talk about that. I'm going to remind you how many assumptions we've made in the round trip time. And we need to be aware of that. You use sometimes the equation, you don't realize how many assumptions it's actually made to get to that point, to simplify things. I'd like to show you what a Poisson arrival process looks like. I know that sounds daft, but I felt very stupid in front of my students because I thought I knew the Poisson process 3-4 years ago. And then when we started discussing it, you realize you think you know things and you don't actually know them. We'll do a potted history. For people here who don't know Del Boy, I'm going to talk a bit about Del Boy, cowboys, so only fools and horses. I'm going to apply concept of a weighted average and then do some conclusions. So a better version of this paper has been published recently, and it's got better equations. So if anyone is interested, they can actually have a look at that. I'm going to try to base more of my presentation on that. What assumptions do we make when we actually derive the round trip time? We've generally assumed, I'm saying the basic round trip time as in 1977 Barney and Dos Santos, if we use that as a benchmark. Equal floor heights. We attain the top speed in one floor journey. So as the speed starts going up, we stop attaining the speed. We actually have to go up and then come back down again. We assume the single entrance. We assumed incoming traffic. We assumed actually a constant arrival process, not Poisson. And we'll see the difference in that. We also assumed independent passenger decisions, and there's been some work recently on that, that the passengers are independent. When they arrive, they don't know each other, and they make their decisions independently. Zero door dwell time, no door reopenings, perfect door timings. I'm sure you can find many other things as well, single passenger entering and leaving and so on. Now, if you want to start making that formula more general, you have to start taking out each one of these assumptions. So you start saying, I'm going to make my formula more general. So let's take away the first assumption and adjust the formula. We want to make it more general. So take out the second assumption and make it more general. And you get to a stage where you lose the will to live. You do. It becomes so complicated. And I think I want to make that point because I think with Monte Carlo simulation, you can take all of that away. So there's an ulterior motive to all of this. I'm going to make you really see why it is so difficult. So let's have a look at the Poisson arrival process. It's a nice Greek letter, lambda. And it actually has units of passengers per second. Now, if it's constant, if it's Poisson, if it's random, you still have that value. That's basically, if you stood in the lobby and you watch the passengers arrive, you will see every 1 second, 0.2 of a passenger, 0.2 of a passenger arrives, and obviously every 5 seconds, a full passenger arrives. Or 1/lambda, more realistically, is every 5 seconds, one passenger arrives. To generate it in software, we take a random number between 0 and 1, we change that into an inter-arrival time, so between the first passenger and the second passenger, there's 4.4, and then that gives us an absolute arrival time. And that's what a Poisson process will look like. So when we say Poisson, this is what I'm saying, if you want to describe something to someone, you really have to understand it properly. And we fall into that sometimes. We think we know something for 10 years, 20 years. When you really think about it, then you know how to describe it. That is a Poisson process. Each X in there is a passenger. We've assumed there's a passenger arriving at the beginning. And then the time between each passenger and the next is a Poisson process. So the Poisson process describes the inter-arrival time between one passenger and the next. The mean of it, the average value, is 0.2. So that's 0.2 passengers per second, or 1 over 0.2 is 5. So the average of those readings is 5 seconds, but it's only an average. And it has an average is 5, but in fact, we're getting lots of problems there. And it's interesting that what Richard said about the inefficiency, the losses in the round trip time, part of them is caused by this random process. If you had a sandwich shop, it'd be nice if during the day your customers arrived every 5 minutes. So you have enough time, you get the sandwich made nicely. But life is not like that, isn't it? They arrive randomly and then you have peaks. But going back, that's a much more beautiful scenario. And that's actually a constant. They both have the same average. But this is actually a constant process. No randomness. And that's what we assume in the standard round trip time. We have passengers arriving every 5 seconds, one passenger. And the standard round trip time assumes that, but you do have actually a lot of the derivation was based as well on Poisson. So when I say Poisson or constant later on, that's what I'm talking about, the difference between this process and this process. Let's have a quick potted history. I apologize unreservedly if I've missed anyone or I've got anything wrong, but I've tried as hard as I can to come up with a potted history. 1923, Jones worked for General Electric. Now, his problem wasn't a problem of elevators. His problem was sizing motors for a tall building. So he didn't care about the elevator. But in order to size the motor, he wanted to know how many starts per hour there was. And the only way to do that, he wanted to know what was the expected number of stops, which is a start for the motor, and how long it takes. So he needed the round trip time, because he wanted to know how many stops there was in a round trip time so he could size the motor. So that was the first, that's 90 years ago. 1955, Schroeder came up with the H, the highest reversal flow. He's saying we don't always go to N, which makes sense. Why don't make use of it? 1977, the basic formula. This is, for me, it's a seminal paper. And it was a supplement to Elevator World. The two gentlemen from Connie, I understand the second one is dead, has passed away, and the first one has just retired. But what it tried to tackle was the idea of a top speed not attained, still assuming equal floor heights and equal floor populations. Peters addressed the Poisson issue, so he had a round trip time equation, assuming equal floor heights and top speed attained, but he actually assumed a Poisson arrival process. So you will get a slight difference in the two in the round trip time. Schroeder tried to amend H and S for destination group control with the advent of M10. Now Barney had two papers, one in 1992 and I think there was one a couple of years or 4 years later to try to amend the formula. We haven't spoken about group control, remember. But you can actually start looking at the formula to amend for group control. So that was 1992, Upbeak revisited. Peters had in his PhD an approximation for the case of top speed not attained in one floor journey, one floor height. You can see how more complicated things are becoming. Another important paper, Henry Hakkinen and Ledelma 2005, general traffic Poisson arrival process. There's one from Connie in 2005. They tried to amend H&S like Barney tried in 1992, or they amend H&S for destination control. I did some work on multiple entrances, and that's where I think Monte Carlo simulation is important. Because you get to a stage where things become very difficult. Monte Carlo simulation, you don't need more than 20 lines of code in MATLAB. And you can actually find the value of the round trip time for any of those conditions, apart from group control. It doesn't address group control. So I think this was actually an important paper because it started laying the basis for dealing with unequal floor heights and top speed not attained in one floor journey. It addressed the issue of top speed not attained in one floor journey, 1978. And for me, I think it's seminal, the definition of seminal, not the rude one, is it's strongly influencing later developments, which is quite, I think that's quite an important definition. So. I'm going to give you a slightly humorous example, but I think there's a serious point to it. So there's a British sitcom called Only Fools and Horses. I don't know, maybe non-British people don't know it, but it was very, very popular. In fact, it was voted as the most popular comedy in 2004, BAFTA, I think. It ran from 1981 to 1991 and some Christmas specials. And it had a character called Derek Trotter, Del Boy. And he's an ambitious market trader. He does a lot of ducking and diving in England, they say, and someone trying to buy and sell and do dodgy deals. And it was voted Britain's best sitcom in 2004. So there's the main character, David Jason. That's the garage they used to store the dodgy gear in. That's their flat. And their company, short is TIT, Trotters Independent Trading. And they had a three-wheeled Reliant Robin. Some of the dodgy things they did, he tried to sell a Sikh turban, cycling helmet to Sikh. They got tapped water and put it in bottles and sold it as Peckham spring water. And there was the famous chandelier where they tried to refurbish a chandelier and they dropped the wrong one. If you look carefully there, you will see. They were trying to hold that one, and in fact, it was the other one that they undid and it fell. And so there is a serious point, but I'll come to it. So I picked actually five of the dodgy deals. I'm going to work with those dodgy deals. So I've assumed that, let's assume he gets one deal a month. And he's thinking, how much will I get at the end of the month? And we're trying to help him. So it's going to be only one and only one. He will get a deal. He will get one of the five deals. One of them will happen in a month. If he gets it, that's it. And we shall list those five. So the first one, DD1, we'll give it the expression DD1. It's a chandelier cleaning job. It pays very well. Takes a lot of effort. But his reputation is so bad now, you will see the probability of him getting it is very low. Better probability with Russian army camcorders. And the best one is the free Nelson Mandela t-shirts after the Nelson Mandela had been freed. Peckham spring water. And painting Dr. Singh's surgery with railway luminous paint. So we're going to take those five deals and we're going to work on them. And the guy is sitting there thinking, I know the probability of getting those deals. I know how much I'm going to charge. How much will my monthly income be? And notice that this is actually not an average. Why is it not an average? Why can't I take, I've got the cost, I've got the income. I've jumped to the probabilities. I should have shown you that. So why can't he just take the average of each one of those deals, add them up and find the average? Because he knows he's going to get £2,000 for the first one, £100 for the second. He can't do that. He can't just add them up and find the average. Why not? Bonus marks for this. Any ideas? No? He can't just take the average of the first, the second, the third, and the fourth, and the fifth.
Different probabilities, yes.
Because the probability of the first one is much lower than the others. Although he can get good money for the first one, it's only going to likely. Now, we call this a weighted average, and a weighted average is very important in the round-trip time calculation. So we looked at the probabilities of all five of them, and they should add up to one. We call these mutually exclusive. Only one and only one of those will happen in a month. Then he knows the income from each deal. So the income from the first one, the chandelier job, is 2,000. £50 from the army camcorders, depending on how many he sells, and so on. So we got the money from those. So we ask, what is the monthly income? What we have to do, we have to multiply each one by the probability of it happening. It's a very nice job, the chandelier job, 2,000, but there's only a probability of it happening 0.01. And then the second one. Now this is called a weighted average. Weighted from weight, how much weight it has, what probability does it have? And his income comes out as 78.9 per month average. If he keeps on working for a long period of time, that will be the average. He might get a good month, he might get a bad month. But eventually, over a long period of time, Monte Carlo simulation, over a long period of time, he will actually get 78.9 per month. How do we apply those? If we have a ground, I lift on another question. This is hopefully an easier one. If we have P passengers in a lift, it's ready to go. The passengers have gone in, they've registered their destinations. They can only register 1 to 10. They are independent. They're not talking to each other, not moving in a group. What possible journeys can it do now from the ground floor? What possibilities do we have? Where could it go to start with?
Any one of the 10 floors.
Any one of the 10 floors, excellent. So, that's a bonus point. 1, 2, 3. Can it actually go from ground to 10? But that's very unlikely, isn't it? Because all P passengers would have selected 10. But if it did, the round trip time would be quite low, wouldn't it? or it will be lower than many stops because it only has one stop and comes back. So these are the possibilities. There are n possibilities or 10 possibilities. So it could go from ground to one, from ground to two, from ground to three. Let's say it's moved on now, it's on the first floor. It's got 9 possibilities. And then it has 8 possibilities. So 10 plus 9 plus 8, we have this is all the possible journeys. We add them all up, and we end up with 55 possible journeys. So really, if we wanted to calculate the up traveling time, we need to find the probability of each one of those 55 and multiply it by the time it takes to do that. So we've started now working on the weighted average. All I'm really trying to do is just give you a glimpse of a simple part of it, how it works and what it does. Because as I said, it does become very complicated. In fact, this we did this at school. It was used to be called an arithmetic series to calculate all of those. If we started 1, 2, 3, we added them all up, you had a formula which is n times n minus 1 divided by 2. And this is part of the formula. So the time going up, in fact, is we have a double summation. And this is the income. This is what we call the income from the deal. And that's the probability of the deal happening. And we sum it up over all of the deals. We have to have I and J because we have to have a starting floor and a finishing floor, and hence we have to have two variables. That just gives you a flavor of part of it. So if we look at that, that's actually a general overview of trying to calculate that. We have an up traveling part, a down traveling part, and then we have stops, and we have. And that's all I'm going to do regarding this. I'm just going to conclude now. So remember, we have too many assumptions. And we have to remember those assumptions. To remove all of them, that's when you get to the final equation. I gave a potted history. And the concept of a weighted average, find all the possible events, find the probability of each event, multiply the probability by the cost or the benefit you get from the event taking place, and then sum them all up. We looked at the Poisson and constant arrival process, and I'm just going to end with, I always say to my students, it doesn't really matter what you cover, it's what you uncover. Thank you much for your help.